And today's topic is I love my church. Yeah. All right? So even if it's not true, could you say this with me? I love my church. All right, we're going to discover what that means today. So I was thinking about this series and about going to church and what is church and who is church and all these sort of things. And I begin to think that there's two types of locations in life. There's locations that you need to go to, that you have to go to, and there's places that you want to go to, right? So if you want good teeth and you don't want them to fall out of your face, you need to go to the dentist, right? You need to go to the dentist. You need your annual cleaning. Now, if you're like me, I have very sensitive teeth. And the entire time they're doing my cleanings, my hands are on the chair and I'm butt shaking. Like, Mike, relax. I got cat. I don't enjoy going to the dentist, but I want my teeth to look okay while I'm preaching, so I have to go to the dentist. So places that we need to go to, places that we want to go to. We're gonna take a minute here. You guys get to be vocal today. Is that all right? Be vocal with me today, all right? I'm gonna put a picture up on the screen, and I want you to shout out your first emotional response to seeing that picture, all right? Put the first location up on the screen. Oh, no. Come on, what else? Boo. What else? Long wait. All day. All right. That's too long for me to write. Teaching tool for patient. Okay. All right, put the next one up on the screen. Ouch. Oh, God, no. All right, let's put the last one up on the screen. Real quick. Someone said yes. Someone said hungry. Someone said I'm about to spend a lot of money I don't have. Huh? Yeah? Okay. Thank you. You can take this off the screen, guys. Three locations that we need to go to. There's instances in which we need to go to every one of those places, yet I didn't hear anybody say, I love to go to the DMV. Even the people who work there that are in the room. It was like necessity, right? You didn't say you love, if you love going to DMV, we do have on-staff counseling available to you after services. There might be something wrong. If you love sitting at the DMV all day just to get to the window and realize you don't have all the proper documentation. All right. Places that we need to go to, places that we want to go to. I wonder, don't shout this out, but I wonder what our gut feeling emotional response would be if we put a picture of our church on the screen. Would it be the same kind of, oh, no? Would it be like, a waste of an hour of my life I'm never going to get back, right? I'm just throwing some stuff out, all right? Put it up on the screen, this question. Do we think of church the same way we think of going to the DMV, or the doctor's office, or the grocery store? And before you sit here and say no, there are people that we are connected to that have an emotional response when we say, would you like to go to church with me? Oh, no. Like saying, hey, bro, we're hanging out. Could you just go to DMV with me? Are you crazy? I'm gonna waste my time sitting with you at the DMV, right? There are people who have this same response inside of them as the going to the grocery store, the DMV, or the doctor's office when asked to go to church. Is church just another place that we feel that we have to go to in order to fulfill our God-given duty as a Christian. Like, okay, because I signed up for Christianity, I now have to go to church, at least on Christmas and Easter. I mean, at least Christmas and Easter, I have to go to church. I'd be willing to guess that maybe it's not you, but someone that you do know, because of the way they were raised as a child and the kind of church they attended in the past, when they hear the word church, they feel the same way as you feel about having to have your annual physical. Yuck. No thank you. Not a lot of fun, right? And so my question is that the kind of church that God intended for us to build? Is that the Acts 2, in the book of Acts, is that the Acts 2 church, the community of believers that Jesus came to build? Was that his idea about this new community of believers, that he would create something that we loathed going to? And I believe that the Bible tells us no, that that's not what he wanted, that that was not God's plan for church. I want to take a minute, and I want to go through our vision statement real quick, tell you what Family Church is about, what our mission is, and it is this. We are a diverse, spirit-filled, life-giving church, healing hurts, building relationships, and developing leaders. This is our mission. Everything we do revolves around these six things. We're very intentional about being diverse, okay? And diverse is not just a black and white thing. It's not just a Hispanic thing, okay? Being diverse is that we are diverse in gender. That if my wife comes up and does something, she's a female, then Reverend Earl came up and did offering. We have a man. So we're diverse in our presence on the stage. We don't just have male musicians, we have female musicians, right? And then we're diverse in being multi-generational, right? So my dad is still very involved in the church, and I'm involved in the church. We have children's church, we have teen church, and we have seniors groups. We're very diverse in our age brackets. But today what I want to talk about is this idea that God gave us that we want to build relationships in the local church. Building relationships in church. We believe that this is what God's plan for the church today is. A diverse group of people connecting in unity to build relationships and grow in their knowledge of God. I believe that that's what God's intention for the church today is, right? I believe that God wants us to love the church, not maybe love what we see on TV. Maybe we've seen some things on TV that have gave us a skewed view of the church that God intended. If you're here today or watching online and you say, I could never go to church because, you know, I see what pastors have done and ruined their churches. Listen, and this is where the problem lies, is when you treat a pastor any different than a normal human being. When you look at a pastor as God instead of a human, you're going to be let down every single time, okay? Because humans make mistakes. Humans have bad days. Let us not follow you around with a camera 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, recording everything that goes on in your life. Or, better yet, let's open your brain to look at the thoughts that go through your mind. Okay? So, we can't judge church based upon a few people who've had bad days. Okay? So, it was God's design for church. So we're going to look at over the series. And let's begin by looking at Matthew 16, 15. If you have Bibles, you can open to Matthew 16. It's the first book in the New Testament, right after that big break from the Old Testament to the New Testament. If not, it'll be up on the screen behind me. It says this. But what about you, Jesus asked his disciples. Who do you say I am? And they said, well, you know, some say you're a prophet. Some say you're Elias. Some say you're from the old times. He said, but no, what do you say I am? So, what do you say about church? What do you say church should be like? What do you think church is, right? He's saying this. And Peter, big mouth Peter, he's always got to be the first one to jump in and make a statement. But this time Peter gets it right. This time Peter being a big mouth is a benefit to him. Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, "You are Simon, son of Jonah." His name's Peter, right? So Peter is the word, is the name Petra, which means pebble. He says, "You are Petra, you are pebble, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." So let's take a moment. Jesus is speaking. Jesus says, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." So just real quick, tell me, whose job is it to build the church? Jesus is speaking, and Jesus said, "I will build my church." Whose job is it to build the church? Jesus. Jesus. It's Jesus' job to build the church. He said, "Peter, your revelation has empowered me to fulfill my calling. I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." So guess whose job it is not to build the church? Mine. It's my job to manage the church he's building. Come on. It's my job to raise up leaders to be part of the army of the church that he's building. Okay, we're getting this. Jesus said, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Put this up on the screen. Jesus takes personal responsibility for building the church. Jesus takes personal responsibility. He says this. The Bible says that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father forever, making intercession for us. Forever in our corner, coaching us and building us and speaking to us and making ways for us. Forever making intercession. It's Jesus' job to build the church. But I don't think that we have a clear picture of what the church is. Because Jesus didn't come here and put a shovel in the ground and build this facility. Did he? No, he didn't. 1 Corinthians 3:16 says this. "Do you not know that you yourselves are God's temple? And that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? For God's temple is sacred." So he's saying you're sacred. "And you together are God's temple." Now, we understand the scripture. Yes, I am the temple of the living God. I understand that the Holy Spirit lives in me. But I think that we consciously understand that we're the church, but we don't actually live it. And I'll give you an example. Had a conversation with someone the other day. They're like, "Pastor Mike, do you do weddings?" "Yes, obviously I do weddings. I'm a pastor." They said, "Great. I want to do my wedding in the church." I said, "Okay, so this is how we can do that. We have a wedding chapel that seats about 100 people. We could do it there. Or we prefer to do venue weddings." No, I want to do it in the church." "Well, there's a few issues about doing it in this room, particularly there's no way to get up on the stage." Right? This room in itself is not really set up to do like these big, elaborate, beautiful weddings that people want. And anyway. So I really encourage venue weddings. Venue weddings are beautiful, backyards, whatever. No, but I want to do it in the church. And so my response is this. You ready? Now this is going to sound weird at the beginning, but you're going to understand it. I am the church. Now, I'm not speaking this arrogantly like, "Well, because I'm the pastor, I'm the church." You're the church. You're the church. Ready? So wherever I am is church. Yo, listen, straight up. We could go sit on the front row of the Yankee game. I could say, do you? "Yes, I do." "We just got married at church. Take me to church. Take me to church. Wherever I am, I'm having a barbecue in my backyard. I'm in church." Yeah, but you know what I mean? I want to be in the house of God. I am the house of God. You are the house of God. The Spirit of the living God lives and breathes and abides on the inside of you. So we understand the theology of that. But we get hung up on this building. We get hung up on this building thing. So let's look. Where can we have church? How do we do church? Matthew 18, 19 says this. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything that they ask for, watch, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. This is the importance of a small group. This is the importance of having family and friends that you can say, hey, listen, I just got a diagnosis. Hey, I'm going through something. Would you pray with me? Where two or three are gathered together. Watch what says this. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, you're at church. He says, there I am in the midst of them. And we're gonna get it. But what about this building? Church is a gathering of believers. Right? It's a gathering of believers. We could have church anywhere because we are the church. Let's just be honest and really look at it. The Acts 2 church didn't meet in the temple. They met in people's homes. They met in coffee shops. They met in restaurants. And it says that they had church. Let's look. We just had our friend, Brandon was here last week. He said they were having church, and three friends couldn't get their buddy into the house, so they tore the roof off. That wasn't in the temple. Good luck trying to get on this roof and rip this off. It was in somebody's home that they were doing church. Church isn't a building. We are the church. We are the church. I belong to the church universal. So what are you supposed to do about that? Okay? We get that. But what are we supposed to do about that? John 13, here's the crux of the entire series. John 13, 34 says this, a new commandment I give you. He didn't say a new option I give you. He didn't say a new suggestion. He didn't say pick or choose what you like. He said a new commandment I give you, that you love one another even as I have loved you. He died for me. You love me? Yes. He says that we're supposed to love each other the way he loved us and he died for us. Do we actually love each other? Love as I have loved you, that you would love one another. Watch this. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. He did not say that they will know you're my disciples by whether you have a leather Bible or a paperback Bible. He did not say that they will know that you're my disciples whether you wear a suit or skinny jeans on Sunday. He did not say that they would know that you're my disciples whether you used foul language or whether you've learned to tame your tongue. He didn't say any of that. He said they will know that you're my disciples based upon the way that you love. The way that you love one another, the way that you care for each other. So what is the church supposed to do? Love one another. And this verse preludes the church. The church hasn't started yet. This is the book of John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. The church didn't start until Acts chapter 2. After the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit falls, right? They receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They speak in other tongues. Church starts. Jesus said, you're not to go start ministry until you receive the Holy Spirit, because you can't do ministry the way Jesus did without the Spirit that Jesus had. So this verse is given to us before the launch of the first church. And he says, you got to love. You gotta love, you gotta love. You gotta build your ministry on love. They will be a people, the Christian belief will be a people known for their love. Church people are meant to love one another. It's not an option. It's not a buffet where you pick and choose whatever you want. You know, so like the Christian world's kind of going to be defined right now by what do we actually believe about Kanye West? We say Christianity is easy to obtain, but he didn't. Where's the love in that? Where's the love in believing the best in others? I'm just saying it's so easy, as if you found Christianity, but he couldn't have. We are to love one another. So a few years ago, I went to a restaurant in town, and I walk in, and I'm just like the aroma of the restaurant, the vibes in the restaurant. It was a modern restaurant, but had a family feel. I'm not going to tell you which restaurant it is, but I go in. I'm like, yo, this restaurant's great. They put me in this big booth seat, and they bring the food out, and I'm like, oh, my God, this food is amazing. And I'm like, Cindy, I think I found my favorite restaurant. I love this place. And like any good patron of a restaurant that I love, I went home and I gave it a Yelp review. I gave it a 5-star Yelp review, Google review, whatever. Oh my God, amazing, love the atmosphere, blah, 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 right? Love it, great restaurant. Earlier this year, my son turned 6 years old. And for his birthday, I did what all good dads do. I bought him a gift that I could play with. Amen. Amen. You know what I'm talking about. He's only 6, but I bought a real basketball hoop that he can't shoot into. No, just kidding. But I'm partly joking. I buy him this gift, and we spend all day putting this thing together, playing with it, having fun. And that night, I'm putting him into bed, and I'm like, hey, buddy, how'd you like your birthday? He goes, Daddy, your gift was the best. I loved it. It was amazing. And he looks at me. He goes, Daddy, I love you. Aww. I went and bought 6 more of those gifts. Melt your heart. And I'm like, buddy, I love you too, right? I didn't go downstairs and Yelp review that. It's a different kind of love. It's a love based on relationship, not experience. There's nothing in that moment that my son did for me that created an amazing ambiance of experience, right? With the restaurant experience, I was experiencing something given to me, a place offering me something. The restaurant fed me and provided me a moment that I could participate in. If the experience wasn't excellent, I would not have given them a 5-star Yelp review, right? Come on, somebody. And if I didn't like the experience, I probably would not go there again. I would avoid it. With my son, I was experiencing an important relationship moment. My son is someone I'm connected to. My love for him isn't based on what I'm receiving or what I'm experiencing based on what he's done. I'm feeling and I'm loving based upon who he is and the involvement in our relationship. Because I love him, I care for him, I play with him, I go through life with him. And that journey might bring some not so great experiences. Like the other day, he needed to take some medicine. And really, the medicine tastes like dog vomit. Because I tasted it. I wanted to see what the problem was. But he had to take the medicine, right? Not so great experience when you're holding your kid and shoving medicine in their face and they don't want it. But I don't go give a negative Yelp review or talk bad about my son because we experience a not so nice moment. I can't rate that. I just love him. The church was never meant to be like a restaurant. It's meant to be based on relationships. We're in a culture today where people church shop. They monthly church shop. This isn't where the culture's at. So go online and we say, okay, let's see of our top three churches in Orange County, who's preaching what series? And if that church's series is going to speak to me, is going to feed me, I'm going to get something out of that experience, then we'll go to that church for the week. And if it's a different church, then I'll go to that church. Which means that we've allowed consumerism to creep into the church instead of relationships like God intended. I'm telling you straight out, I'm not always going to preach a message that's going to land with you. We're going to have these ups and downs. We're going to have some weeks where you're like, oh my God, that was the greatest message. And then there's going to be other weeks where you're like, I think he lost his dang mind. Jesus wants us to be in church based upon the community of the church, based upon relationships that we form in the church. And this first and foremost begins with a relationship with Jesus Christ. Through that relationship, we don't have to have anything in common. We don't have to have any of the upbringings. We don't have to like the same sports. We don't have to have any of the same hobbies. We don't have to have been raised on the same side of the tracks. The only thing we need in common is that we know Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, and that there's one way to eternal life, and that's through Jesus Christ. And he says, based on that revelation, that's the only revelation that we need to build the church. That's why Peter's revelation was so great. He's in front of Gentile and Jew and Pharisee and Sadducee. Nothing in common except the Messiah. The Messiah. Jesus Christ, the anointed one, and his anointing. Based on that, we have everything in common. Based on that, we have eternity in common. Right? Jesus intentionally, God Almighty intentionally served us and loved us. And we get that confused too, right? We get this whole thing like, I've got to serve God, I got to serve God, I got to serve God, I got to serve God. Just remember what Jesus said. He said, I didn't come here to get served. I came to serve you. I came to serve you and show you to serve one another. How can you raise one hand? I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Shut up! I love God so much, but you hate your brother. He said, you're not my disciple. He said, you're not my disciple. You're not my disciple. I love you, Lord, but I don't like Republicans. I don't like Democrats. Red or blue, which one are you? I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God. Come on, I know I'm being a little controversial here, but I'm just saying. He says, you know you're my disciple, not by how much you say you love me, but how you actually love each other. I do believe that many people treat the church like the DMV, like going to the dentist, like the grocery store, like a restaurant. As long as the church is doing everything they like, they'll keep giving it good Google reviews and come back. And I was going to say, that's beyond unacceptable. It's beyond unacceptable. It's like, I really wish that people couldn't Google review church. Because if you have something wrong, I'm going to say this to those who are watching online, if you have something wrong with the church that you're going to, just shut your mouth and go to a different church. Like, how is giving something, a church, a bad review going to build the kingdom of God? at all. That's just not for you. And go to a life-giving environment that you can, you know, follow God at, all right? This is an expectation. This sets the church up for an expectation that can never meet. I can never meet the expectation of preaching a sermon every single week that's going to be exactly what you need to hear. There's just going to be some weeks that you can, like, sow that sermon into somebody else who needed it, right? Because I'm here because you're here, right? Amen. We'll love the church. We will love the church when it's about the relationships in church, when it's about the relationships, when we're intentional about building those healthy relationships. Let me just throw this out there today. If you've been married longer than 10 years, if you've been married longer than 10 years, you may have lost those little butterflies every time she or he touches your hand. But you can get to a place where you feel more in love when you're intentional about sowing into those moments. When you're intentional about saying, I love you, looking in each other's eyes, even though you don't feel it. And going on a date, even when you don't want to, and you'd rather do something else, right? Being intentional about sowing into the not-so-loving feeling moments. And that's how it should really be in church. I don't always feel like getting up on a Sunday morning to go be this guy. But I know for the benefit of one person hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ, I will. Amen. Amen? This whole series that we're talking about this month is called Heart for the House. What does it look like to have a heart for the house of God that Jesus intended? It's going to be a four-part series. I'm just going to throw it straight out to you. I'm not going to be here next week. Pastor Earl is going to be filling in for us. Amen. Pastor Earl is the gentleman who received offering today, okay? He's got a really great dynamic story of how he's going to present the gospel of Jesus next week. You don't want to miss out on it, okay? I will be watching online, participating in community with you guys. So if you want to hit me up on the gram, I'll be on the gram while we're watching, all right? Here's the idea. We don't want you to just become a member of the church for the sake of checking it off on your religious card of duties. We want you to be a thriving part of a life-giving community. Amen. We want you to connect and have a relationship with somebody else. We want to create environments in which if there's something that you're going through, you can reach out to somebody, that our kids can play together, that our kids can grow up together in church and know each other and share information and text each other and call. Like, we want to create that environment now in our lives. And that's the church that Jesus was designing. Yes. Let's just think about Jesus. He made room for people that there was no room for. He said, suffer not the little children to come unto me. There was no place for children in that time. He drew women out of obscurity and said, no, don't push them away. Come, I have something to share with you, right? And listen to what I'm saying to you. This is what Jesus said. Listen, come here, I'll teach you to. And this is the community that he wanted us to be in today, based on relationship, being in the community of relationships, being connected with one another, ensuring that no one stands alone. I'm really excited about what God has for us this season, this series. And then we're really excited about what we're planning for December and where we're going. We have a big Christmas production planned for December 22nd, all right? It'll be the Sunday before Christmas. But today, if you came in here and you realize inside yourself that there's a little bit of a void, that you want to build life-giving relationships, but you haven't started the most important relationship, and that's with God. If you're in here today, and even as I was speaking, you're feeling something different about today. Like, something's literally happening on the inside of you that as I'm speaking, you're feeling these words. You're feeling drawn and compelled to be part of a life-giving community. I would just say that that's the Holy Spirit knocking at your heart. The Bible says this, that God comes and he will knock on your heart and said, if you'd let me into your life, I'd come in and I'd sit with you and I'd share the secrets of my covenant with you. And so today we want to offer that to you. We want to offer you the greatest relationship that you could ever start in life with Jesus Christ. And here at Family Church, we make it very simple. We want you to pray a prayer, a salvation prayer. And the salvation prayer is a confession that Jesus is Lord, inviting him into your life, and starting that relationship with him. And we love you so much that we don't want to leave you standing alone, but we want to pray it with you. And the prayer goes like this. Dear God, I come to you just like I am. I believe that Jesus Christ is my Lord and my Savior. Jesus, I accept you into my life to change me and to make me new. Thank you for accepting me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Woo! I just want to take one more second and ask, if you prayed that for the very first time today, would you allow me the opportunity to celebrate you for just 2 seconds? Could you just wave at me and say, hey, I prayed that prayer for the first time today? Anybody here real quick? Over here, I see you. All right, yeah. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? I see you, all right. Yeah. All right, man, I see you. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, thank you, thank you. There's a booklet on the seat back in front of you. It just says, Welcome Home. That's our gift to you. It talks about Christianity, what we believe here. We'd ask if you just took a second and maybe fill out that card and make yourself known or stop at one of the high top tables. We'd love to welcome you into the community of Christ, into a relationship with him. If you need prayer of any kind today, we have some prayer partners in the front and at the high top tables in the back. If you'd like to see me, give me a hug. I'll be down here right after this prayer. Father, we thank you today that your word will never return to you void, but it will accomplish exactly what you set it out to do. So, Lord, today I bless everyone the sound of my voice, that they're the head and not the tail, above and they're beneath. Everything they set their hands to will prosper and be successful. In Jesus' name, amen. Love you.